right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Dan's Talk. We have another exciting episode today with nobody else but our own Louis van Amstel. And, you know, I remember Louis from a long time ago. And the first time I really watched it was when there was this epic battle between Ralph and Olga Müller and Louis van Amstel and Julie Fryer. And they actually won, very surprisingly so. And I saw that on TV. And since then, I couldn't take my eyes off them. And then his career obviously went on. You know, he was world champion. He went to America, I believe it was 97, became US citizen, and then went on to become US champion with Karina Smirnoff, who you all know. And then he became really famous because he was on Dancing with the Stars for many seasons. And I'm sure you remember him. And last but not least, he also has his own workout brand. I'm sure you already did La Blast. Welcome, Louis van Amstel. Here we go.
Yay.
Thank you for having me, ladies. And Babette, well, thank you for that lovely introduction. Yes, it was a long time ago, and what a battle that was in 94 and 95.
I know you did. That was really awesome. It was amazing.
I actually also remember that competition, mm-hmm. and it really went down. I think that the judging at that point was open marks, and it yes. came down to a jive, and it was in Germany, and I think it's the German judge who also gave you a first place. I mean, it was epic.
It was quite an experience, and it's 26 years ago, but it still feels like yesterday because, and this is the beauty, I don't know if we're going to be talking about this, but visual marking is necessary for our industry and the couples, because we are a living example. We lost the first dance. We lost the second dance. As a matter of fact, the first dance, we were third, not even second. We were third, then second in the second dance, and then we won Rumba, Paso Doble, and then it was all about it. It was the German judge who never judged again after that one in Germany, because he gave us a first in Rumba, and that was the deciding dance, because that means if we win Paso Doble and Jive, we won. And the American judge was the fourth first place in Jive that made us the majority of first. So, yeah, that was quite a...
It's truly epic when they do judge open. You can push yourself even more, right? The energy kind of creates this, oh, I gotta fight for this place.
You do, and I think it's exciting for the audience too, because they're participants. They see everything. And then, of course, you have the real fanatics that are writing down all the judging scores, and they themselves are looking at, oh, well, okay, this couple is first, this one is second. Well, if this one does better, they could still win. I mean, it's very exciting. And I hope the United States is going to introduce
that would be
marketing.
Exciting, at least for pros, that would be, you know, something that can stimulate them and give them a little bit more fire while they're performing.
It affects and people in a very chance. Different way, you know, some like if you're suddenly getting marks that you think you didn't deserve, you know, and people actually go, and sometimes it does reverse, it inspires you. So it's, but it's definitely more pressure. I always feel it was more pressure, but politically, I also feel that you can't just give somebody sixth place when they're fighting for the first one, when you have to put that open mark. Because with the closed mark, people could literally do that. They're like, I don't want this couple to win. I want my couple to win. So I'm going to give them sixth place for like no reason at all.
it's pressure on the definitely on the judges. And I think, Yelena, from the four of us, you judge the most. And it is pressure on the judges too. It holds you accountable that you have to show your marks. So I've had this conversation with many organizers here. They're still scared to do it. Because what's going to happen if that judge does sixth in dance one, and suddenly by dance three, they are doing what every other judge is doing. And this is why I would suggest right after the finale, you will have the top six couples plus one coach or one person, whoever they want in that room, with the moderator and all the judges, a press conference that you can have 20 minutes with the judges, and you can ask, why did you put me six? Why did you do six in dance one and first in the jive? why did you change your mind? It looks very fishy. And then there's a moderator that will make, and this is broadcasted. Everyone will hear and see what's going on. Would you do it, Yelena, as a judge? Would you be on that panel?
Because I'm not really that much involved in politics of the couples. So I always feel it's easier for me to judge because like I just do it the way I do it. So it's like, if I have to justify my mark, I'll have no problems doing it. I personally do not.
This industry needs more people like you guys.
Yeah, I'm not attached to any dance party, let's call it that way.
Judges shouldn't. And if we want to make this a more honest, objective industry and give our young dancers the chance at an Olympic Games, we need to look ahead and do what any other sport does. They have the competition and the coaches are going into a room, and then all the networks are now, all the journalists are asking questions. Why couldn't we have that and hold our judges accountable? I would love to be on that panel. And I would love to be the one that does six and everyone else does first. I would love to get that microphone. And I would be proud of that moment when a judge could honestly say, I'm here for the dancing and I judge what I see, not what I know from the past. And I didn't know we were going to go here in the first 5 minutes.
But I know, right?
Yes, yeah, but this is so exciting. We never talked about this. This is awesome.
I personally would love if we had a few marks to give. We do have time, especially in the final, to do that. Let's say give technical mark and then a performance mark and the musicality. Let's say for me, those things are important and score them differently because some people are so much more interesting to watch, but they have not as defined technique, let's say. They're just fun. And then there's some people that are reversed. They're like really good at technique, but just so boring to watch. So if we had those different scores, then I think the result would be more fair.
I believe that that's why we have the show dance, because each couple goes one-on-one, because you couldn't do that in a final with six couples. You don't have enough time to divide. I mean, it's great if that were to happen, but then in the final, you would have to have one couple solo, but then you're going to spend a lot of time because if you have to do six solos times five, that's 30 solos to make that happen. That's why I think in ice skating, it's only one dance and also, or one program, and they do it also for the whole entire year, but they only have one couple, one program. We have five dances and sometimes six, seven rounds.
Yeah.
But the fact that we're having this conversation, I think, is great. And I truly hope that the NDCA will listen to the younger pros and the younger judges to say, we need a revolution, really. A good one, a positive one, not protesting one. There's enough of that in the world. get the right people together. But don't you own a competition, Yelena?
I do own the competition, but because mine is one day competition, we're not allowed to run pros. We can run like a top amateurs, we could, and maybe it would be interesting idea to do just that one time final in amateurs with open marks. I guess I'll have to check the rules. Is it allowed or not? That's the question.
Well since you're organizing it, maybe you can bend the rules a little bit, huh?
I don't know.
It becomes a time question because at our competitions, there's so much going on and we already now have that rule that we cannot go past a certain time, like past midnight, because I remember big events that lasted till like 2 o'clock at night. So, you know, it becomes a really like a logistic problem as well. So I think if we take that thought and think how we can select it out for the professionals or for things, we just need to calculate in a lot of extra time. I think that's a big deal.
Yeah, well, I think, and this, because I've had many of these conversations with competition owners already, and that was the number one reason from Lee Wakefield or any head of judges that does the timetable. There is no time. There is not even a conversation head. We have no time. Well, how many times do Pro-Am go on that floor uncontested? It's just because of this. Money-making. Visual marking is maybe not money-making, but it's adding something unique to regular boring competitions in the same old ballroom with the same, just the same competitions over and over. You have to cut a few of the pro-am competitions, and I would say it's easy. The uncontested competitions, you just need 10 extra minutes per, we're talking 10 minutes. So if you have four pro comps, that's 40 minutes extra that you would have to do. But I think people are scared to do it, and that's why. Because if you really want it, you make it happen. We got two Russians here and two other Europeans here. And if you really want it, you can, well, I was being diplomatic.
I think it would bring more entertainment. If anything, our pro-am pays so much money to be there watching professional show on the end of the event. I think it could bring more entertainment value to it.
I think how each couple handles themselves while being on the floor, while knowing where they are at, you know? It's like you can really see who is a competitor at mine and who is falling apart mentally.
Yeah.
That is another level. Mm-hmm.
And that is why gymnastics, why ice skating is so popular during the Olympic Games. I mean, if the media, which happened in China when they had the Olympics there, they wanted to pull out gymnastics, and they said, if you pull out gymnastics, we walk away, because the networks make the most money from gymnastics and ice skating, and they're both judging sports. We are as close to that as possible. And coming back to visual marking, the European competitions that are always visual marking, they're still being watched today. And not just because of the dancing, it's the anticipation of the marks and what it does mentally. Babette, you hit it on the nail, standing there, losing the first two dances and then winning the rumba. What it does to your psyche is amazing. Right. And then in us, we had to have iron stamina mentally in the first two dances. But then if you are the person that won the first two, but you're losing the third, and now you see you're losing the fourth, the jive is the deciding
factor.
It is a mind bender. But you know what? That makes you the athlete.
And it makes it more fair. So.
Yes. Because the judges also, I mean, that German judge, I mean, I can only talk about my experience, that German judge, for him to put up a first, I actually thought that he was going to give us the sympathy first. So he would say, well, I'm staying a little neutral here because we're in their hometown, in their home country, with half their studio in the audience. So let's give him a little bone. But not knowing that three other judges did the same and it gave us the majority. So anyway, I think it would be a great idea. And if you want to test it out on amateurs, I think it's great.
Awesome.
What I'm also interested in is, like, we've talked a lot about the competitive dancing, and you know, you were one of the greatest competitors out there. But recently I see on Facebook, I follow you a little bit, that you changed your life completely. You moved to Utah. And you actually are father now. So I would actually love to hear about this. And, I know you adopted two boys, I believe. And you adopted them when they were already a little bit older. So I would love to hear about that experience and that part of your life and how are you guys doing?
Well, where are we going to start? I
want to know everything.
Oh. So Babette, even though we know of each other, we haven't really interacted with each other too much, but we know each other for a few years. Well, on the other side of the screen, Yelena and Snow, I know for over 20 years. Mm-hmm. And if you would ask me 10 years ago, you're going to be married, you're mm-hmm. going to live in the mountains, and you're going to be a parent, I would tell you, you're
absolutely
nuts. Because, you know, in our business, what do? We get on a plane and we teach, and we go from one studio to another. We judge competitions, we compete. We're like gypsies. And I thought, this is my life. And even when Dancing with the Stars started, I was living in West Hollywood, had a lovely penthouse with a rooftop. That was,
it was
the life.
Beautiful.
And now I'm a business owner. It was beautiful, and it served its time. But there was a plan, a bigger plan for me that needed to balance out, that it cannot be just about work and money. It has to be a balancing act. So when I opened my mind to that 10 years ago, it started with building Le Blast and then finding Josh, my husband. And then we made, actually, we were in Austria, in Graz, mm-hmm. for the Special Olympics. And that's when we opened our website, the website, Heart Gallery of America. Every state has one. And on that heartgallery.com website, you find thumbnails of over 500,000 kids in foster care. And right there and then we decided we're not only going to adopt, we want to adopt older kids, 5 or older. For the simple reason that everyone who wants to adopt a baby. Because yeah. for either biological reasons, you can't birth your own. Well, then adopting a baby is the close second. Well, I'm here to tell you, it doesn't matter what age you adopt. The moment in your head you decide, this is my child, Papa Bear comes out when something, someone goes after that child. And we feel like we are the parents of our 10 and 11 year old. And did we miss the first 10 years? Well, I do not miss the diapers. I don't miss having to listen to
wipe their butts.
No, I'm good with that. And partly because we have a lifestyle that involves traveling. Even my husband and I, we love to travel, not only for work. So the kids are old enough, they can jump on a plane. Our first son, Daniel, saw 5 states and 3 countries in Europe within the first 6 months of being in our home. That is the beauty of adopting older kids. And a month and a half ago, we took placement of our second son, Jonathan. And it's wonderful, but we have our hands full. There's a lot of triggering and there's a lot of trauma. They both have been heavily abused. The second one is more than the first one.
Because you're dealing with a whole history and memory of these two children, which is possibly when they didn't have it very good. So you have to like probably study a lot and be very considerate in how you manage to create this safe space or this safety for these two boys.
Absolutely.
So they have, because they didn't get this parent trust that we all got when we came out of families that where we were wanted, you know.
Yeah, and the father is unknown for both boys. They don't even know the father. Mm-hmm. Mother is dead, stepfather is dead.
I got a pleasure of meeting those boys, and I guess when I met them, you know, there was no drama, none of that. It was they were very lovely and they were very loving. And for me, what amazing was, because at that point, Jonathan was only like, 3 weeks with you guys? Yep. And he was already calling you dad. And that was just so like, literally, I don't even know how to describe that emotion. When you look at someone and he's like now in his dream house and the parents are nice and he has all those things and he's already calling you dad. It was amazing. It was just amazing to see.
It's very emotional too.
Yeah.
Very emotional. Because when you read about the children, you get 1400 pages that we have on medical reports, what happened to the parents and how were they treated, the abuse, the physical abuse. I mean, these young souls, they didn't ask for that. And so we are in a position where we can be parents and we couldn't birth our own children. And it's lovely as a same-sex couple that we now are in a period where we can adopt, and we had no problems adopting our 2 children. And we can't wait to go to court, because we have to wait another 4.5 months before we can go to court to be the official parents. Right now we are the custodians. And it's...
But not of Daniel, of John. Daniel is...
Jonathan. Daniel is our son. We went to court December 19th. We wanted to do this before Christmas last year. And we did. And half his school was there. Family members flew in. Our family members flew in. And it was very special, because it was just 1 week before Christmas.
Wow.
We hope to do the same this year.
This is so exciting. I don't mean to steer off. I actually want to call you, Louis, and ask more information about that. just for my own knowledge, but I want to actually ask you about your classes that you're doing. I'm sorry, I'm unfamiliar because we haven't been in touch for a while, but tell me about this project that you presented to the world.
La Blast.
La Blast Fitness, which is no longer a project. It is a worldwide business now, and we went worldwide last year. And it's quite amazing. Again, if you asked me 11 years ago, you're going into the fitness industry, I would say you're absolutely crazy. So after season two, I had Lisa Rinna season two, and she asked me to start a class because she blamed me for being addicted to ballroom dancing because of Dancing with the Stars. Great. So I started one in Sherman Oaks. And then in 2010, I had the offer to turn it into a program with Crunch Gyms. So in 2010, flew to Holland, tested it out there to see, well, if I would get the opinion, an honest opinion, I just have to go back to my home country, present something, and they will give me the truth. I could probably go to Russia too. So, anyway, they loved it. So I came back and we turned it into a program. So what is La Blast? I have been, like you guys, since the age of 10, a ballroom dancer. I had a huge career, and I'm proud of that career, but I guess inspired by Ruud Vermeij, my coach, my mentor. He did his PhD on La Bonne with ballroom dancing. To be able to get a PhD, you have to bring something new to light that does not exist. So what he did, La Bonne with ballroom dancing, and he has become famous for it. And we were the guinea pigs at that time.
Yeah, I remember that.
So I thought, I'm not going to university, I'm not going to college, but what would I do if I would bring something new to the table with ballroom dancing? And it clicked. I took ballroom dancing into the fitness industry, and now La Blast is 100% a full body workout. And for that, it's a long journey, because for that, you have to do your certifications that we don't have the way we do. You pass your exam, you are a pro. Whether you do this the legal way or you do it with a glass of wine and you just have the right people to give you your certificate, it doesn't matter. In the fitness world, you can't. You have to do ACE, AFA, AEA, whatever world organization there is. I did them all. Because if you want to be successful, you have to live by example. So I got my ACE and AFA group fitness certification. And then because we have an aqua program called Splash as well, ballroom dancing in the pool.
Wow.
Did that one. And you really learn what it is to do fitness. We all go to the gym, right? But you work out for yourself. But now you have to create something that anyone, and I'm talking about anyone of any fitness ability, age or color, anyone should be able to do it. That's what I did with La Blast. And recently, the last 2 years, I am beyond proud of what that program entails. Yelena, you were certified, 4 years ago.
Oh,
it's not even the same program.
Yeah.
But what I love doing with La Blast, and hopefully soon dance studios will notice it more and see the value of La Blast, is you teach even quick step, Lindy Hop, Jive, Viennese Waltz, American style, international style, smooth and rhythm. You teach people, general public, in their fitness gear without them knowing the skill of dance. And you would think that when you add weight training, when you add plyometrics, when you add muscle endurance, that the dancing waters down. And that was my biggest goal, to not water down the dance quality, and yet you are doing plyo, you're doing interval training, etc. And right now within the fitness industry, we're earning a place in the market. We had to go against Zumba for so many years. And as big Zumba is, Zumba has really, I don't know anymore what it is, if it is Latin-based or if it's just world rhythms and hip-hop and all.
I find it's more hip-hoppy right now. Like, I took a few Zumba classes because of the studio. We had Gina.
I don't know, but what I do know is...
Sorry, it's a bit delayed. Go ahead, Louis.
No, it's and Gina was after me or before me when I would teach La Blast at your studio.
Right.
And one thing that I'm really excited about is to represent the ballroom dance industry in a complete different industry. And I think people are slowly starting to realize that I'm not here to be away from our business or to take advantage of the business. No, it's an opportunity to create opportunity in dance studios, opportunity for ballroom dance instructors that need more income, that want to work on their health. And this is one thing that I didn't know, that I'm right now in better shape than when I was competing because of my company. So it's really lovely to see pros that are joining in on La Blast, that it keeps their body the way it was when they were competing. And if I see some of my colleagues right now that are judging, that I think, what happened? I mean, I know things go south, but they don't have to go south that much that you think you just aged a decade. Because when you judge or just teach, it's not enough for your personal health. You have to do more activity because it cannot be just about money. So I feel personally, to wrap it all up, in a very balanced life, I feel, and even COVID-19 has kind of triggered us all to look inside and say, am I living the life that I want? And Yelena and I, we talked about this 3 weeks ago, and sometimes making a major change is refreshing, and we're fearful of change. And that's what I'm here to stimulate, change.
I love it. I absolutely love it.
What we also have to do is, like what we usually do, we have a quiz for all of our people that are on our show. So we have to do this real fast because we were talking for so long that we don't have so much time left. I think, Elena, you're quizzing today, are you?
Yes, I'm going to start.
And I'm good if it's because of me, because I said a 45 minute, I kind of switched my meeting. So
that's okay. Yes. Thank you, Louis. So let me know if I'm breaking up too much, because then somebody else should quiz.
But I would switch if you want me to, yeah. But you can start. Go ahead.
Okay. So describe yourself in 3 words.
Bend the ruler.
Good one. What's your favorite body part?
Legs.
What drives you absolutely crazy in people?
What drives you absolutely crazy, Lee?
Liars.
Oh, yeah. Okay, if you could time travel, where would you go? Which era?
Oh, 20s, because right now I am hooked, line, and sinker on Downton Abbey.
Ah, okay.
The 20s in England.
All right. What is your dream vacation?
Caribbean, catamaran, island hopping.
Island hopping. Oh, I like that. On a private jet, right?
Well, a private boat, yes.
Okay, good one. If you can shop for free in just one store, which store would you choose?
Well, the diplomatic side says a supermarket because I need food to stay alive. But Hugo Boss, I'm going for Hugo Boss.
Oh, Hugo Boss, nice, nice clothing.
Yes.
Okay, what is your useless talent?
Useless?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, well, I couldn't say dancing.
Oh my God.
Tennis.
Okay. What is your guilty pleasure?
Chocolate.
Ooh, chocolate. Okay. Do you have a favorite quote?
I used it last week for La Blast, President Carter's. Stop talking, start walking.
Good one. Okay, what's the best advice you ever gotten?
Don't listen.
Okay, I love that one. Don't listen. All right, and the last
one. I want to elaborate on this one. I read a book, To Be Successful by Not Listening.
Wow.
We listen too much to a lot of people wanting to give you good advice, but it's oftentimes out of jealousy or envy, and they are acting out of fear. Should you do this? Maybe you shouldn't do that. Maybe you should do something this. Be safe. No, listen to your gut and move on. Stop talking, start walking.
All right.
I love this one, Lily. I'm gonna meditate on this one.
Right? So if you would have to thank someone right now, boom, who would that be? First person.
Ruth Vermeij.
Ruth Vermeij. Yay! All right, that's it.
Oh, well, that was quick.
That's it, 10 questions, very fast.
Yeah.
Right.
Good. Thank you so much for joining us. It's truly, like, for me, it's so nice to hear from you. It's very nice to hear all your thoughts. You definitely opened my mind to a couple of things that I need to rethink and rewatch this video. I love all the messages that you give us. So thank you so
thank
much.
You,
thank you for taking the time and being here with us. Thank you.
Thank you. And I support what you guys are doing. It's really good. Stay out there and female empowering, and good luck with all your workshops coming up very soon. I believe.
Thank you. We're
thank
super
you,
excited about
keep doing
that.
What you're doing.
Thank you, Louis.
Bye.
Bye, everyone. Bye.